From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Clinical Reviews, interviews and ideas about innovations in medicine, science, and clinical practice. Here's your host.
Welcome to this JAMA Clinical Reviews podcast. I am Dr. David Simel, Associate Editor for JAMA. In this podcast, we will be discussing foot and ankle discomfort. To address this topic, we are pleased to be joined by Dr. Minton Truitt Cooper, who is an Associate Professor of Orthopedics at the University of Virginia. Dr. Cooper is the lead author of the review Common Painful Foot and Ankle Conditions that appears in JAMA in the December 19th, 2023 issue. Dr. Cooper, thank you for joining us today.
Thank you for having me.
So I think all of us have or will have foot or ankle discomfort, which if we're lucky, resolves on its own. Of all the things that can cause foot and ankle discomfort, how did you pick Morton's Neuroma, plantar fasciitis, and Achilles tendinitis as the targets for your review?
As the title of the article suggests, these things are fairly common. You know, plantar fasciitis, for example, recent studies showed over 1 million visits a year in the U.S. alone to doctor's office just for plantar fasciitis. Additionally, these things are, I think, both amenable and appropriate for non-operative management, which can certainly be started in the primary care office by generalists. And so I think many of these patients can be treated without a surgical consultation. So those were the primary reasons.
Well, let's start with Morton's Neuroma. Your article has some really nice illustrations, and I found the one for Morton's Neuroma particularly helpful. Can you tell us what a patient feels and the physical findings we would pick up and then the management for the patient's problem?
I think the most common things that patients will report with Morton's Neuroma would be pain in the ball of the foot. So what a Morton's Neuroma is it's really a fibrosis or scarring of the nerve. It becomes enlarged and gets entrapped between the metatarsal heads. Most of the time, it's between the third and fourth metatarsals, so that sometimes they'll report pain or tingling or electrical sensations radiating into the affected toes. Up to 85% or so are found between the third and fourth metatarsals, with the remainder between the second and third. Sometimes the pain will be exacerbated with wearing tight shoes, narrow toe box shoes that'll kind of compress the metatarsals together, or also stretching the toes. As far as diagnostic criteria or physical exam findings, the most common and appropriate tests would be things like the thumb index squeeze test, where basically you're compressing that space between the metatarsal heads with your thumb and your index finger. There's also the Mulder's sign, which includes doing that, but also compressing the metatarsal heads from medial to lateral. And the illustrations in the article really show those tests nicely. Thirdly, you can perform a Tinel's, which is just basically a repetitive percussion of the nerve on the plantar aspect of the foot, seeing if it reproduces any symptoms. So those would be the main diagnostic criteria.
You mentioned that a Morton's Neuroma is a fibroma. Is the fibroma something you can actually feel?
Well, it's not really a fibroma. It's more of a scarring around the nerve. They call it perineural fibrosis, but basically it's just forming a sort of a shell of scar tissue around itself.
Do I need imaging to diagnose it?
Not typically. I mean, I think most of the time imaging, whether it be radiographs, MRI, or ultrasound would be used if the diagnosis is unclear or in some cases to rule out other pathologies. For instance, if it wasn't clear whether it was coming from, say, the second MTP joint or metatarsal phalangeal joint or from the nerve between the second and third metatarsal heads, you might obtain a radiograph initially or an MRI to look for abnormalities of the joint. But mostly it's a clinical diagnosis.
As a primary care provider, what can I offer my patient?
I think avoiding inciting activities, you know, recommend wide toe box shoes, sometimes with a little bit more cushioning. Injections can be a pain reliever. They may not cure the problem, but they can offer some pain relief with a corticosteroid injection. Orthotics, not necessarily custom-made orthotics, but an orthotic or shoe insert designed to take the pressure away from the ball of the foot and the nerves with often what's called a metatarsal pad or a metatarsal bar.
Are the inserts something a patient buys over the counter?
I generally would recommend that. Custom-made orthotics for many of these conditions have not been shown to be necessarily superior, and they're much more expensive, often insurance not covering them. So yeah, I would recommend starting with an off-the-shelf, over-the-counter insert.
Okay, so Morton's Neuroma, as you described it, is in the forefoot, but plantar fasciitis is more in the hind foot. Can you tell us what the plantar fascia actually does?
Plantar fascia is a collection of really three bands of tissue, basically that run from the plantar heel, the plantar calcaneus, all the way out to the proximal phalanges of the toes and plantar plates of the MTP, or metatarsal phalangeal joints. And what it does is it helps support the arch during gait. So when a person's walking, as they go from sort of that flat-footed stance phase to push-off, the toes are passively extended, and that pulls the plantar fascia tight, therefore supporting the arch, making it a more rigid arch, more rigid lever to push off with and propel you forward. So it has a job. Most of the time we think of it as just a pain generator with no function, but it does have an important job.
When a patient comes in and tells us they have flat feet, is that a problem with the plantar fascia?
Not typically. I mean, many people in the world have flat feet all the way from children through adulthood, and it's not necessarily a pathologic problem. There may be some patients with flat feet may also have plantar fasciitis, but some people with very high arch feet may have plantar fasciitis. Plantar fasciitis doesn't necessarily lead to flat feet, and there's not been a lot of evidence that, say, a plantar fascia rupture necessarily causes someone to have a flat foot. Flat foot's usually from other factors outside of just plantar fascia pathology.
But what symptoms does a person with plantar fasciitis experience?
Yeah, so number one is heel pain. Heel pain in the bottom of the heel, the plantar aspect of the heel. Usually, if you're really specific, most of the time it's going to be sort of to the medial or inner aspect of the plantar heel. Pain often is described as excruciating with the first steps in the morning or after getting up from a long car ride when the tissue is very tight. That's number one most common thing we see. Also, we do see once they get moving, a lot of times it'll settle down, a little bit of light activity, but with prolonged standing, they'll describe sort of a toothache pain coming back in the heel to the point where they have to stop.
What can we do for the patient with plantar fasciitis?
Well, I think the first thing we can do is try to set expectations that there's not going to be any quick fix for this. I think a lot of people think it's very common. There must be something easy to do to just make it go away. But as the paper indicates, there's some studies that show that sometimes it can persist for years in some people. It usually gets better, but it can be there. So as far as primary treatments, I usually start people on sort of a course of a home stretching protocol. I'll show them some exercising. Again, these are shown in the illustrations in the article. Stretching both for the calf musculature, the gastrocnemius and the soleus, but also for the plantar fascia itself, I think is important. And some studies have shown that plantar fascia stretching specifically needs to be incorporated. I think that in some cases, arch support type orthotic can be helpful. And again, the studies don't really show any benefit to a custom-made orthotic, but there is some benefit potentially to using some sort of a longitudinal arch support to decrease the strain or stress on the plantar fascia. They want to avoid exacerbating activities. If someone's an avid runner, they may need to take some time off from running. There is some overlap with jobs that require people to stand on hard surfaces. Sometimes that's just not possible.
Avid runners are avid runners for a reason, and that's because they love running. So if an avid runner keeps running with plantar fasciitis, are there any negative consequences to that other than that their feet will continue to hurt?
Yeah, that's a common and sometimes difficult question to answer. Personally, I don't think that they're doing a lot more damage. If they can run through it, I think it's okay. It may make it more painful. It may make it last longer. But I don't think, unless they're really changing their gait and overloading other part of their feet or affecting their hips or knees, I don't think that they're doing a lot of damage. I know people who have run through plantar fasciitis. Eventually, it's gone away for them. There's no, to my knowledge, and having reviewed this pretty extensively, I don't know of any specific data that says that continuing to exercise is going to cause other problems.
All right, well, let's move to Achilles tendinitis, which can cause pain where the tendon inserts on the back of the heel or higher up in the mid portion. What do you consider the mid portion, and what do we do on physical examination to evaluate for Achilles tendinitis?
Yeah, so as you mentioned, we talk about two different types of Achilles tendinitis, and the focus of this article was more on the mid-substance or mid-portion Achilles tendon. And that's, I think, generally considered about 2 to 6 centimeters proximal or above the insertion or attachment of the Achilles tendon. To evaluate it, first thing is just to listen to the patient and have them describe their pain. Differentiation of the two is important, as well as differentiating from something, you know, more extreme, like a ruptured Achilles. But generally, they'll describe pain in the Achilles. It's often going to feel a palpable thickening of the Achilles on physical exam. It'll be significantly tender right there in that 2 to 6 centimeter proximal range. There's a couple of specific tests, and these are shown in the video. One is called the painful arc sign, and that's basically the examiner palpates or squeezes the painful portion of the Achilles tendon. And as the foot's taken through a range of motion in plantar flexion and dorsiflexion, that painful area actually moves as the tendon moves up and down. I think this can be used to distinguish from things such as peritonitis, where the actual lining of the tendon is inflamed, and that'll sort of stay localized despite movement of the tendon. Another test is the Royal London Hospital test. And that's an interesting test, and I don't think anyone knows why someone would have, you know, the specific result of that. But basically, as the tendon is palpated, it elicits pain. And then when the ankle is taken passively into dorsiflexion and put the tendon under strain, the pain actually dissipates. Again, it's a fairly specific test, not all that sensitive. Additionally, when you're evaluating this, I do think it's worthwhile just to check to see if there's any signs of a ruptured Achilles tendon. That would include things like a palpable gap in the tendon, significant bruising, the patient describing an actual acute event. And then you can test things like a Thompson sign or a calf squeeze test, where basically the examiner squeezes the calf up proximally and watches to see if the foot passively goes into a plantar flexion, which would indicate that the Achilles tendon is intact and not ruptured. And again, those are shown in the video as well.
The video you mentioned is on our JAMA Network site and accompanies your article along with the illustrations. And in the video, you also show how the patient can be instructed to do what's called eccentric exercises for the Achilles tendonitis. What is an eccentric exercise? What's happening when a person does that?
So eccentric exercise is basically something, it can be any part of the body, but we're talking about the calf muscle and Achilles complex here. Basically, the muscle is contracting while lengthening. It's considered sort of the negative work. It's absorbing a little bit of energy, but it's still lengthening. So in this example of the Achilles or the gastroc soleus complex, basically the patient will be on a stair or a block, and the eccentric part of the exercise is them slowly lowering themselves. The concentric contraction or work is when they're rising up on their tiptoes. And so with those types of exercises for the Achilles, you know, as described by Alfredson 25 years ago, the patient will do 15 repetitions, three sets, but they'll go up on primarily the non-affected foot and then down slowly on the affected side. I think one thing to consider in that is that if you have a patient who's very acutely tender in a really exacerbated state of Achilles tendonitis, they may need a period of rest before they could jump into those kind of activities. But I think that there's pretty good evidence out there that shows that that's a beneficial treatment.
Well, the eccentric exercise certainly looks like something a primary care clinician could instruct their patient in. Is it known why it works?
There are several theories to this. And the short answer is no. I don't think it's completely understood why it works. There's been some thought that there's some sort of structural adaptation within the tendon, but I think there's been some work that shows that the clinical improvement happens before you really see that. Some people have theorized that it lengthens the tendon. I think that's not been found all the time. Other ideas come from just that the muscle power, the increase in muscle power that's developed alters the way that tendon is loaded. And in relation to this, it may be that the muscle becomes more effective at its spring activity and can reduce the energy that absorption that the Achilles. That's some of the recent reading I've done. But in short, nobody knows exactly why it is. And it's probably a combination of all these things.
When we're talking about risk factors for Achilles tendonitis, most generalist physicians will tell you they've heard about an association between fluoroquinolones and the predisposition to Achilles tendonitis while on those medications. How much of a risk factor are we talking about for a patient on fluoroquinolones?
It's pretty small. I think that the sort of increased relative risk for Achilles injury is about 1.24. It is increased a little bit with glucocorticoid use in conjunction with the quinolones, but it's still small. And the overall incidence is really about 0.5%.
Well, finally, I hear from my patients about platelet-rich plasma, or they may have already received an injection of platelet-rich plasma for either plantar fasciitis and Achilles tendonitis. What is platelet-rich plasma, and how strong is the evidence to support its use when simple things aren't working?
So platelet-rich plasma, often referred to as PRP, it means a lot of different things. It's sort of a heterogeneous combination of things. But basically, it all involves drawing the patient's blood, putting it in some sort of centrifuge device, and trying to concentrate the part of the blood that contains platelets and growth factors that theoretically can help these tissues heal. It's highly variable, I think, both from individuals. So if you take the blood from two different people, you may get different formulations, but also there's lots of different kits out there designed to collect this, and they'll come up with different levels of growth factors, different numbers of platelets, as well as white and red blood cells in the platelet-rich plasma. And so I think that's sort of made it hard to really identify what the best formulation is to use. This may be an example of where marketing got a little bit ahead of itself, and the companies that created these things really pushed it 15 years ago, and the science wasn't there, and it's still not there. If you look at the data for plantar fasciitis, there's some evidence that it does show a slight improvement compared to corticosteroids at year follow-ups. Achilles, there's not really been shown to be much benefit at all for the mid-substance Achilles tendinopathy at this point.
Thanks for describing platelet-rich plasma to me. Are there any other novel treatments for Achilles tendinitis?
Extracorporeal shockwave therapy, or ESWT, it's often referred to, is another treatment that I think has a lot of promise, probably both for plantar fasciitis as well as Achilles tendinitis. I wouldn't say it's new. It's been around for a while. One of the difficulties with it, though, is that it's not typically covered by insurance plans, and so it's hard to get it paid for, it and it's hard to come by. Some of the different methods of using it require some even anesthesia, and if insurance doesn't cover the procedure itself, it won't cover the associated anesthesia either, so it can become very expensive. But I think there's, especially for plantar fasciitis, there's some pretty good evidence that it may be beneficial.
Well, thanks for explaining that to me. Is there anything else you would like our listeners to know about these common foot disorders?
Yeah, I think that, as we've said, they're common, and most people are going to have one of these at some point in their life, hopefully not more than one of them. A lot of them can be treated non-surgically, but there's not a lot of quick fixes. Injections can help. Corticosteroids can help with pain relief, but they don't tend to offer much in the lines of cure. So I think they need to be patient. I think that most of these can be treated for several months before they need to be referred to a surgeon. Obviously, there may be some extenuating circumstances. It's a lot of counseling with the patients, because a lot of times these can be pretty disabling. It can keep people from performing the activities that are important to them, both from a health and fitness standpoint, but also from an occupational standpoint. And that's hard to say, hey, wait 3 months and this will probably or possibly get better when they're having trouble working.
Well, thank you, Dr. Cooper, for joining us today to talk about Morton's neuroma, plantar fasciitis, and Achilles tendinitis. This episode was produced by Shelley Steffens at the JAMA Network. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at JAMA Network Audio, all one word, .com. Thanks for listening.